came to Cuernavaca 20 years ago when they had a year of Dynamical System, and ever since he's had lots of contact with the Institute. He was the physics supervisor of Carlos Cabrera and also Rogelio.
He's going, he's, the title of his talk is
Dynamics of Dissipative
Thanks a lot, and thanks to the organizers for the invitation. It is a great pleasure to be back here. So indeed, I came here as one of the first visitors to this institute. It was in February, almost exactly 20 years ago. It was absolutely beautiful here. Everything was blossoming. And I had indeed a great time, very productive time. And indeed, Alberta caught all mistakes in my manuscript, so it is very came out very clean. So, and ever since I tried to come so regularly, and I think that I visited at least 5 times, which is the third place on my traveling list, yielding only to Rio and Paris. So, the Cuernavaca is the third. So. Right, so, well, the last time it was 4 years ago already for Alberta's second fest. And at that time I started a discussion of dynamics of dissipative complex Hinnon maps, and today just will follow up. So it is just a report of the progress during these years. So, and of course, I have to recap some of the material I talked about last time. So people who were here 4 years ago, feel free to leave and come back in 15 minutes. So then, so here is the basic setting. So we were interested in dynamics of complex polynomial automorphisms of C2, and the basic example is a generalized Hinnon map, a map that has this form, just explicit form, P of X is some polynomial of one degree, one variable of degree at least 2. And it looks like quite special example, but actually it is very representative example, and the general theory is developed along the same lines exactly. So I will talk about this example, but everything I will be talking about will apply to general non-trivial polynomial automorphisms of C2. There are some trivial cases that will just that are not interesting from the dynamical point of view.
What's
a non-generalized would be the classical Hinnon map corresponds to the quadratic polynomial. And here is just polynomial of any degree. So that is the whole difference. You see that there are here several parameters. So one discrete parameter, it is the degree of the map, and the main continuous parameter, so the main modulus is this parameter B, which is the Jacobian of the map, which does, it's independent of the point complex Jacobian, it is constant. For the purpose of this talk, the Jacobian will be assumed to be less than 1 in absolute value, so which exactly means that the map is dissipative. So a different case is conservative, it is different theories that I will leave. So today it will be out of the scope of our discussion. and in fact, I will need later on to impose a stronger conditions on B, but we will discuss this along the lines of the talk. If B is equal to 0, then the map degenerates to a one-dimensional map, so just it will, so the, so the so everything degenerates to the dynamics on this parabola x is equal to p of y, and so for small b you think of this map as a perturbation of one-dimensional dynamics, and that is the right philosophy. So dissipative Hinnon maps should be considered as small perturbations of one-dimensional polynomials. And of course we can start with understanding what is going on in one-dimensional theory. It is very well-developed theory. So let me remind you what is the situation in dimension 1, and then we will see how far we can generalize it to the two-dimensional case. So here is one-dimensional polynomial dynamics. What is beautiful about it is that on one slide, I can just recall all basic notions. So we start from infinity. So infinity is superattracting point, and we consider the basin of infinity, all the points which escape to infinity under the dynamics. And then we consider the complement of this basin of infinity. It is what is called the field Julia set, so some sort of schematic picture. So that is the basin of infinity, here the orbits escape to infinity, it is a complement, and it may have interior, so as I have drawn, but may or may not have interior, but in any case, so the boundary of this field Julia set is what is called the Julia set. It is a common boundary of the basin of infinity and the field Julia set. And also there is a notion of the Fatou set. In this case, it is just the interior of the field Julia set, usually consists of infinitely many components, and the basin of infinity. So it's just the complement of the Julia set. That is the basic notions. Well, the theory is very much related to the nature of periodic orbits that are present in these dynamics. Well, so everybody knows what periodic orbit is. That is the definition of the multiplier of the periodic orbit. And the orbits are roughly classified according to the values of this multiplier. If the multiplier is less than 1 in absolute value, then the point is attracting. If it is greater than 1, then the point is repelling. And most delicate case, it is a neutral case. When the multiplier is in absolute value equal to 1, then it can be written in this form. And this is called the rotation number. The rotation number of our neutral periodic point. And if the rotation number is rational, then the point is called parabolic. Otherwise, it's called irrational. And sort of the nature of the dynamics depends very strongly on the arithmetic of this rotation number. And in particular, this point may or may not belong to the Julia set. If the point does not belong to the Julia set, it is called Ziegel point. In this case, the dynamics is linearizable near the point. It can be by conformal change of variable. It can be reduced just to the rigid rotation. That is the Ziegel case. And if we consider the Fatou component, kind of the Fatou component which contains our point, so I am drawing the fixed point, or you can think that it is just a fixed point for some iterate of the map. So if you consider this Fatou component containing this fixed point, then it is called a Ziegel disk. Ziegel disk. The dynamics is globally linearized, can be globally linearized on this Ziegel disk, can be brought to the rigid rotation by this rotation number theta. It is an easier case when the dynamics, at least locally near this point, is very well understood. And the other case is called a Cramer point. Cramer case. It is a case when our fixed point belongs to the Julia set. So there is a Julia set. It can look like that. And somewhere here there is a fixed point, and the set looks very nesting near this fixed point. It is known that it is not locally connected, and topology is not very well understood, or very poorly understood actually, near this point. So there has been recently some progress in this direction. That is the hardest case, so Cramer fixed points. And we are going to discuss all these cases in the context of the Hanon maps. Well, and there are classical theorems. So that there are only finitely many non-repellent cycles which could be bound in terms of the degree of the polynomial. So I wrote here the bound d minus 1. Actually, the bound, the classical bound of Fatou was by 2d minus 1. It is the number of non-repellent periodic orbits by Fatou was bounded by 2d minus 1, but of course he realized that the correct bound should be without this 2, but it took like 80 years before it was proved. It was proved by Doherty and Hubbard in the paper when they introduced the notion of polynomial-like maps, and then there was a very famous generalization by Shishikura to the case of rational functions, with very non-trivial application of new techniques at that time in the 80s of the techniques of the quasi-conformal surgery. So, but in any case, for us, what is important is that there is some bound in terms of the degree for one-dimensional dynamic for one-dimensional polynomials, and it is related to the fact that somehow one could associate to every non-repellent cycle in some way one could associate a critical point. For instance, if the cycle is attracting, you can take the basin of attraction of the cycle, basin of attraction, and there is a critical point. Critical point must be in such a basin of attraction. It was known by Fatou, and this immediately gives the bound d minus one, the bound of the number of attracting cycles by the number of the critical points, and it is exactly d minus one. And another classical important result that the Julia set is can be also defined as just the closure of the set of repellent cycles. The repellent cycles are dense in the Julia set. And that is also the summary of the basic classical theory, well, except that, well, one more slide I will need for the full summary of the theory. Well, that is just a typical Julia set, typical picture. So that is the basin of infinity. This dragon is a field Julia set. The skin of the dragon is a Julia set. And in this case, you have an attracting cycle of period 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Attracting cycle of period 8. And here there is a critical point here in the center. There is a critical point right in the basin of this attracting cycle. So, and now, so the next question we can ask is, so to give some models for the dynamics of our polynomial, and so we have this dichotomy between regular and chaotic dynamics. We have regular dynamics on the Fatou set and chaotic dynamics on the Julia set, and of course there is a much better chance to understand the regular dynamics, and indeed it was largely understood classically. So Fatou, Julia, and Ziegel understood what happens on periodic Fatou components. Periodic Fatou component, it means that Fatou components which under some iterate comes back. And there are very few types of dynamics on such components. It could be either an attracting basin, and again I am drawing here a fixed point, or you can think this is just a return map. So fixed point for the return map to this component. It is either an attracting, so there is an attracting point, and it is the component of the basin of attraction. So the basin of attraction usually consists of infinitely many components, like in this dragon. So all these components of interior of the Fatou sets are in the basin, but there are main components, which is called the immediate basin. It is the components which contain the points of our cycle. So, and that is one of these components that I'm drawing here. That is a component of the immediate basin. So if the component is periodic, it is in the basin of the attracting cycle, or it can be in the basin of a parabolic cycle. And here I have drawn a fixed point with rotation number, say, 2/5. And here, so these petals are permuted with this rotation number, and the orbits converge to this parabolic point under the dynamics. And it's also called the immediate basin of attraction for this point. Or it could be a Ziegel disk, so it is a neutral fixed point where the dynamics is linearizable near this point, and that is a Ziegel disk on which the dynamics can be globally on this disk brought to the rigid rotation. And that is it. These three cases is a full list of possible dynamical behaviors on the possible dynamical behavior on the periodic component for polynomial maps. But for rational maps, there is one more interesting case, which is a close relative to a Ziegel disk, which is called Erman-Rhin. It is the same situation, except that instead of Ziegel, the topological disk, we have a topological annulus there, and we have a rotation, a rational rotation on this topological annulus. So somehow it is not present in one-dimensional polynomial dynamics, but there is an interesting related question in two-dimensional situations. That's why I would like to mention this this possible possible case. Okay, so what is left after this classical description was the question whether there could exist wandering domains, so some domain whose iterates are pairwise adjoint, some component of the Fatou set which is not eventually periodic. If it is eventually periodic, then it can be classified so as described here. But if it is not eventually periodic, then it could create some complicated so dynamical features, in particular some complicated structure of the Julia set. And this question, so it was question was raised classically by Fatou and Julias and was answered 80 years ago by Dennis Sullivan in the early 80s when he introduced new tools to this field, the tools of quasi-conformal deformations. Roughly speaking, he showed that if such a component existed, then there would be an infinite dimensional deformation of our map in the space of polynomials of the same degree. So, and in the space of polynomials of given degrees, finite dimensional, that's where the contradiction would come from. So, but it is very powerful techniques, which was had been used in Kleinian groups by Alfers and Bers before, and Sullivan realized that it is very much relevant to holomorphic dynamics and to this classical question. So that is a very satisfactory picture. So after that, so after Dennis's theorem, after Sullivan's theorem, just that is all we can have on the Fatou set. It's a very satisfactory description in the one-dimensional situation, and one can wonder what is going on in the two-dimensional situations. So let us switch to dimension two. So let me remind you again, so we are dealing with this Hanon map, which is dissipative. Jacobian is less than one in absolute value. And here we can give very fast the same definition. The definitions were given by Hubbard and Oberst-Wurst in the late 80s, early 90s. So, but there are two versions of each definition, because now the map is invertible, so it is now polynomial automorphism of C2. So the time can go forward and the time can go backward, and accordingly we have two versions of every object. We have a forward basin of infinity U plus, so here the orbits escape to infinity in forward time, and we have backward version of basin of infinity U minus, where the orbits escape to infinity in the backward time. So in my very schematic picture now, it is a schematic picture for C2. Certainly we cannot draw really realistic pictures, but this caricature shows the basin of infinity, which is the complement of this green set. This complement of this green set is the forward basin of infinity. And the complement of this red set is the backward basin of infinity, where the orbits escape to infinity in the backward time. And you see, so I have drawn them asymmetrically. Asymmetrically, these two sets, because there is an asymmetry so related to this dissipation assumption. So, and because of this dissipation, the forward non-escaping set, so K plus is a forward non-escaping set, forward field Julia set. You see, the complement of U plus is called K plus, and the complement of U minus is called K minus. And the set K plus can have non-empty interior, and the set K minus cannot have non-empty interior. Its interior is empty. So that is why because of the dissipation, because of this dissipation assumption. And then we define exactly two versions of the Julia sets as the boundaries of the field Julia sets. So here is a scheme for the J plus. J plus is this one, but actually it is a complicated fractal set, and that is the scheme of J, schematic picture for J minus. So, and roughly speaking, you can think of J minus as a lamination, so something which is foliated by some copies of C, and each copy of C is dense in J minus. It's not a correct picture, but it is a rough idea of how J minus could look like in good situations. And J plus also roughly speak as something which is foliated, vertically foliated by the copies of the complex plane, and each of these complex planes is dense in J plus, but it has a fractal structure. They said J plus has a nice nice conformal structure in the vertical direction and has a fractal structure in the horizontal direction. So it is, it would be an example of elimination. But still, these pictures are much better than usually, much nicer than usually these sets look like. So, okay, so we have these versions of the basins of infinity, field Julia sets, and that's not it yet. That's not the end of the story, because we can now intersect these sets. So K is the intersection of K plus and K minus. It is schematically here, the union of these three curves. And this is the set of points which don't escape neither in forward type nor in backward time. They stay bounded. The full orbits here stay bounded on this set. And J is the intersection of J plus and J minus. It is schematically this set of points. Of course, it is a complicated fractal set. And also, there is one more very important set. It is the set J star, which is a set of the closure of the saddles. So saddles, so it's periodic points with, well, everybody knows here what is saddle, so let us consider periodic points with one eigenvalue in absolute value less than one, another eigenvalue in absolute value greater than one. It is saddles, and saddles sit in this set J plus, and we can take a closure. And one dimensional analogy would suggest that this closure should be equal to the set J, but it is unknown. Maybe it is not true, actually. So, but it is one of the very interesting open questions in this area, whether J plus is actually equal to J. Okay, so that is the basic picture for basic objects for the complex Hannon maps going along the lines of one-dimensional dynamics.
What is the blue curve?
Now, this does not have much dynamical meaning, so it's just there is some bidisk. It is just some bidisk. And it is known that here, if you take this sector in the complement of this bidisk, that the orbits here escape to plus infinity. As if I wanted to describe this picture in more detail for you, I needed to select some big bidisk. And actually, I will need it for further purposes. And then there is a very well understood dynamics in the complement of this bidisk, so near infinity. Here orbits escape to plus infinity, here orbits escape to negative infinity, etc. All right. So, and now let us try to classify for two components. And the classification was initiated by Beckford and Smiley in the 90s, who roughly classified for two components as a recurrent or non-recurrent, so which is a questionable term, but I will use this term. And recurrent means that there is some point alpha here, and there is some point z here, such that the orbit of this point z accumulates on the point alpha. Maybe it goes away, then it comes back, etc., etc. So omega of z, the omega limit set of the point z, contains alpha. So there is a point which does not escape to infinity in these domains. And Bedford and Smiley classified recurrent for two components as either attracting basins, so there is this point alpha could be an attracting point, and then everything would converge to this attracting point in this basin, or it could be a basin of rotation domain. So there is a Ziegler disk here, or Hermann ring, so one-dimensional complex curve isomorphic to the round disk or round annulus on which the dynamics can be brought to rigid rotation, and everything, and this curve is an attractor for our domain. Everything converges to this curve, so just rotating, asymptotically rotating along this curve. And this is two cases, so either attracting basin or rotation basin, but unlike the one-dimensional situation, it is still unknown, so whether the Hermann rings can appear in this situation. So it is an open question whether one can realize Hermann rings in polynomial dynamics. It's very easy to show in one-dimensional dynamics that they cannot appear. In two-dimensional, it is an open, interesting open question. Okay, but so what is left? Still, what is left? Main question which was left after this theorem was what happens in the non-recurrent case. So in the non-recurrent case, by definition, all the orbits escape to the boundary of our domain, but they can escape in a complicated way. The omega limit set can be very complicated in the question whether it really can happen or not. You know, in the one-dimensional situation, according to classification, classical classification, in the one-dimensional situation, all can happen is that they escape to some parabolic cycle. And so whether it can be generalized to two-dimensional, so the question was opened for couple of decades, and recently we resolved it with Han Peters. So by showing, well, under some additional assumptions that the map is moderately dissipative, or now we tend to call it substantially dissipative instead of moderately dissipative. The definition of substantial or moderate dissipativity is that the Jacobian not only less than one, but is bounded by 1 over d squared, where d is the algebraic degree of our map. And under this assumption, we showed that if we take a non-recurrent for two component, then the orbits in this non-recurrent for two component actually converge to a parabolic point on the boundary. So there is a parabolic point on the boundary, and the orbits just converge to this point as in one-dimensional situation. So for this, in this substantially dissipative case, everything looks, classification of the periodic for two components looks exactly the same as in one-dimensional situation, except for one pending question whether Hermann rings could exist in two-dimensional situation. Only in this point I think that I recapped more or less what I talked about in terms of the results talked about 4 years ago. So I don't have much time for outlining a proof of this result. I did this 4 years ago. But what I want to emphasize is the role of this condition. So where this condition of substantial dissipativity comes from. And it is related to the classical theorem by Wiemann from the early 20th century. So it is the theory about just one-dimensional entire functions. So assume that we have a one-dimensional entire function, which I would like to denote by y here. So just a holomorphic map from C to C. And assume that this function of slow growth, so the growth of this function is so like bounded, so logarithm of the absolute value is growing like that. So the order of growth is less. The order of growth is less than 1/2. It is slow growing function, and if this function is non-constant, then if we take the sort of sub-level sets of these functions, the components of the set where this function is bounded by R, then these components will be bounded. So just if we take the pre-image. So you have this function y, and you take some disk of radius r and take the pre-image of this disk of radius r, then this full pre-image will consist only of bounded components. That is impossible, that there is some unbounded component for the pre-image. So this is impossible. This is classical Wiemann theorem, and so it is some kind of maximal principle or Fragment-Lindelöf principle. So the sort of extreme case to consider here, to keep in mind, is just the following. Take half axis, r plus, and take the function cosine square root of z. So this is an entire function, because cosine of z is even function. This is an entire function. And the order of growth of this function is exactly 1/2. For exponential function, the order for cosine function, for exponential function, it is 1. For square root, here the order will be exactly 1/2. And this function is bounded on the positive axis. So it is bounded, it is non-constant function, and it has this critical growth 1/2. So it is counterexample. It shows that the Wiemann theorem is sharp. It's sharp. If we put here 1/2 instead of 1/2 minus epsilon, then it will be violated. So, but if now we have some function whose growth is slow, whose order of growth is slower, then it is impossible. And so in the case when it is just R plus, it would be the classical Fragment-Lindelöf principle, and Wiemann theorem is a generalization of this classical Fragment-Lindelöf principle. And so what is our application? How to apply this Wiemann theorem to our situation? So if we have some periodic point, so say saddle point, for instance, then there is some eigenvalues and an absolute value less than 1, and we can consider the stable manifold of this point. And this stable manifold, it was known to Poincaré, and then was generalized by Alberta to some interesting Hanon situation. Then this stable manifold is a copy of C. So it is isomorphic to C. And now we can consider, so on this C, we can consider the function which is just the second coordinate. Now we are in C2, and now our entire function will be just the second coordinate, which I denote y. It is a complex coordinate y. So, and if it happens that this function is of slow growth, then the pre-images of the disk of radius r will be such properly embedded disks in the complex plane rather than some unbounded. Unbounded components are forbidden. And what is beautiful, that it's very easy to calculate the order of growth of this function. The order of growth of this function is equal to the logarithm of the algebraic degree bounded by the logarithm, I should have put absolute value here, by the logarithm of the stable eigenvalue. So, and under our assumptions of being substantially dissipative, so this eigenvalue is sufficiently small, so that this order is less than 1/2, and we are in position to apply the Wiemann theorem. And it gives a huge extra control. So just this mere fact that here we have properly embedded disks rather than something wild, something which can accumulate somewhere, it gives a huge control of the situation. And we use this Hahn, we used it in some work with Romain Dujardin in other situation, and then we will use it next in what I want to tell you about. So the next question is whether there could be wandering components. We classified, at least under this extra substantial dissipativity assumption, we classified the periodic components. So the question whether wandering components exist. And quite recently, an example of wandering components in two-dimensional situation was produced by the team of 5 authors. So, and this example is related to the parabolic phenomenon. You see, so you need to have a parabolic point. Both eigenvalues here are equal to 1. So it is not dissipative example. So it's not dissipative, and it is not invertible example. You can take such a map, which is a global endomorphism of the projective plane, but it would not be invertible. So wandering components, wandering domains can exist in two-dimensional situation, but not, at least it is not known yet whether they could exist in the Hanon situation. And that is our question, whether the wandering components could exist in the Hanon situation. So how one could approach this question? One could try to generalize Dennis Sullivan's argument. So, but this argument is related to the technology of quasi-conformal deformation. And this technology is very problematic in the two-dimensional situation. So it is actually useful still along certain curves. It is useful, and I will give you one example, or actually a couple of examples, if I have time. So when this technology is used, but when you want to deform the whole map globally, the map in C2 globally, it seems to be useless. So the hope is the following. In the one-dimensional situation, we have many special classes of maps. So the simplest class would be hyperbolic maps, but then you can relax this condition, and you can consider the maps of Yacob's class, which are not renormalizable. You can consider certain special classes for which you don't need Sullivan's machinery. You have so good geometric control of these maps, then just from this control you can easily derive that there are no wandering components. And then you could try to use similar geometric methods to specify a certain class in dimension 2 where you can prove the absence of wandering components. And I think that it is the best bet how to approach this problem in dimension 2, and maybe eventually one could show that, at least generically in some sense, there are no wandering components. And maybe one could produce a counterexample. I think that counterexamples quite likely should exist. But I don't know, of course. I cannot say for sure. Anyway, so the class that we considered with Hahn-Peters is the class of maps which is some relaxation of hyperbolic maps that is called maps with dominated splitting. So the official definition, one of the simplest geometric ways of understanding this in our setting is the following. If you take a point on the Julia set, J, so then there is an invariant cone field. So there is a cone attached to this point such that the whole cone field is strictly invariant with respect to the naming. The image of this cone is strictly contained into that cone.
It's in the tangent space.
It is in the tangent space. It's tangent cones here. So in our situation, that is the legitimate definition of dominated splitting, just existence of the invariant cone field. And under this assumption, of course, so in hyperbolic situation, if the map was hyperbolic, then it would be like that. But in the hyperbolic situation, you have horizontal expansion. In the dominated splitting, you may or may not have expansion horizontally. But if you have contraction, this contraction should be weaker than the vertical contraction. So that is what this condition tells, that the contraction, vertical contraction, dominates possible horizontal contraction. And we classified it as a recent result. So we have not even released the manuscript yet. But so we have a full classification of these maps with dominated splitting, which actually shows that they are very close, ultimately they are very close to the hyperbolic maps. So under this assumption that the map is substantially dissipative, so that the Jacobian is bounded by 1 over d squared, which would allow us to use the Wiemann theorem. And the statement is that under these assumptions, there are no wandering components, there are no rotation domains, neither Ziegler rotation domains nor Erman rotation domains, there are no Cramer points, and Cramer points means that one of the eigenvalue of the Cramer time, so the point on the Julia set with one eigenvalue, neutral and irrational, and the other must be less than one, the other one must be contracting because we're in the dissipative situation. And moreover, these maps may have only finitely many attracting or parabolic cycles, but of course we don't have any bound, unlike the one-dimensional situation, we don't have any bound on the number of attracting and parabolic cycles, and probably it does not exist. So probably because of the possible Neuhaus phenomenon in the two-dimensional situation, probably such a bound does not exist, but at least we have finiteness. So it says us that the map with dominated splitting must be either hyperbolic or parabolic. Roughly speaking, that is the answer, and everything else is ruled out. And in the real dynamics, such a result had been known for quite a while. It is due to Pujals and some Barina, and it was actually inspiration for our work. And so our statement is very close to what they obtained in the real situation, but of course the machinery, the tools are completely different from the real tools. Okay, so I don't have much time to tell you about the proof of this theorem, but I think that I started later, so I may have.
the dominated splitting is a hypothesis?
It is our hypothesis. So we have two hypotheses. We have the hypothesis, I did not put it in the theorem, sorry. So that is standing assumption. It is then dominated splitting plus moderate dissipativity. So yes, sorry. That is, of course, the very, very strong statement. So it needs strong conditions. So. Such maps exist. So Radu and Tanase, who are now postdocs in Stony Brook, they constructed examples of such maps, but Petobin one-dimensional parabolic maps. So, but this theorem tells us that basically, that is, so well, hyperbolic or parabolic maps are all that can be observed in this situation. Okay, so what was the idea? What was initial our observation? So now let us pretend that we don't know the Sullivan theorem. We don't know that wandering components don't exist. So how would we prove the analogous one-dimensional statement? So the condition of dominated splitting in one dimension amounts to the absence of critical points on the Julia sets. So dominated splitting corresponds to no critical points assumptions. So assume that in one-dimensional situation, we know that on the Julia set, it's schematical picture of the Julia set, very ugly, sorry. So, but assume that there are no critical points here. Can we prove that there are no wandering components? And the observation is the following. In this case, so the possible critical point, so which would could lie in the wandering component, behave in not that bad way because its forward orbit must accumulate to the Julia set. And it means that this critical point would not be recurrent. So the accumulation set of this critical point does not contain the critical point itself because the critical point is in the Fatou set and the accumulation set is in the Julia set. So we have non-recurrent critical point, and the situation of non-recurrent critical points was studied by Manet in the 80s, who actually get a very nice geometric control for this kind of for this kind of situations. Of course, he did not care about wandering components. He assumed that the critical points on the Julia set are non-recurrent, and the main thing, the main lemma he was able to prove is the following pullback statement. If you take a small disk and you around the point on the Julia set and you start to pull it back, so pull it back under the dynamics, then the degree of these pullbacks will stay uniformly bounded. So the degree will not grow if the critical points are non-recurrent. And we realize that this machinery can be applied to prove the no wandering components in dimension one, and there could be a chance to generalize it to dimension two. And indeed, so we did this in the two-dimensional situation. And here is, let me give you just a couple of points of the proof. The first point, the first entry point is just the observation that under the assumption of the dominated splitting, the whole set J plus is foliated by the copies of C. So it is because the stable manifold, there are still, under this assumption, there are still strong stable, there are still strong stable manifolds, and each of the stable manifolds is a copy of C by the standard, so Fatou-Virchowski reasoning. So, and the next observation that because of our assumption of the substantial dissipativity, if we cut these leaves of this foliation by disk, then we will obtain disks which are properly embedded in this complex plane. We cannot obtain these unbounded components, which gives us some kind of semi-local leaves inside of the by disk. We have some lamination in the by disk by some semi-local disk. But the problem, of course, is the degree of this semi-local leaves. It is bounded. It's finite by the Wiemann theorem. Actually, it is bounded, but still it is not constant, and it creates a sort of very interesting subtleties in dealing with this situation. And then we use the lambda lemma many times to extend this lamination from J plus to some neighborhood of J plus. And then just we try to mimic the one-dimensional argument by taking some complex line, just purely horizontal complex line, and pushing it forward. We have obtained some curve inside of we will obtain some algebraic curve in C2, and then on this curve we will take some nice holomorphic disk and we try to pull back this disk, controlling the Kobayashi diameter of this disk in the appropriate domain and controlling the degree of branching of this disk. So, well, of course, I in the remaining -2 minutes, I cannot give you any details of this argument, but just let me mention that there is one interesting subtlety here, is that, again, comparing with a one-dimensional situation. In one-dimensional situation, it is very easy to control degree on the wandering components, because there are only finitely many critical points. Then we know that when we iterate, so when we take the wandering component, it is a disk, and we iterate it forward, when we know that the degree is uniformly bounded, just because there are only finitely many critical points here that we can meet. And in the two-dimensional situation, we don't have such nice reasoning, but so one of the important parts of the proof is to show that actually inside of the wandering components, we have a control of the degree. So namely, eventually the wandering component can be trivialized, it can be uniformized by the straight cylinder, foliated by the complex planes. So the wandering component, it has this trivial structure. Okay, that is as much as I can tell you about some pieces of our argument. And just to finish, let me mention that with Stony Brook postdocs Tanya Firseva, Remus Radu, and Raluca Tanasa, we studied hedgehogs in the two-dimensional situation. So that is the hedgehogs as the objects which give some interesting information about the dynamics near the Kramer points. In the one-dimensional situation, they were introduced by Peretz-Markov. So if you take a Kramer point, so it is some neutral point which is not linearizable, rotation number is irrational, hence the point is on the Julia set. If you take a small disk around this point, then there is a connected set containing the Kramer point and stretching all the way to the boundary of this small disk, which is invariant with respect to the dynamics in forward and backward time. And this set is called the Peretz-Markov hedgehog. And so it is a very interesting object which gives some interesting control of the Kramer points. For instance, it can show, using these hedgehogs, one can show that there are no orbits converging to the Kramer point. So no orbit can converge to the Kramer point. So that was one of the interesting conclusions. And in particular, there are no wandering domains converging to the Kramer points. So we studied this situation with these young people. And we showed that in the dissipative Hinon situation, we also can construct hedgehogs. So for the semi-Kramer periodic points. Why it is not obvious? It is not obvious for the following reason. We can always consider the central manifold of this point, but this central manifold is usually non-analytic. So it is a manifold with finite smoothness, and so that is why we cannot directly apply the one-dimensional theorem just to get a hedgehog in two-dimensional theorem. But what happens that on this central manifold, which is smooth manifold, we can make a quasi-conformal change of variable to bring our map to the analytic. To the analytic form. So that is one of the applications of this machinery of quasi-conformal surgery deformations in two-dimensional situation, but it happens, of course, along some two-dimensional manifold. So it is not one-dimensional analytic manifold, but two-dimensional real manifold, and after some change of variable, you bring your map to the analytic form. And the main lemma here is to show that when we iterate our map on our central manifold, that all these iterates have uniformly bounded quasi-conformal deformation. That is the main lemma. I don't have time to explain this lemma, so it is not difficult. But that is how the argument works. And it, for instance, the application is that there are no wandering components which converge to a Kramer point in our situation. So another occasion when we can rule out certain type of wandering components. Thank you. Sorry for the delay.
So this dominated splitting condition is somehow analogous to semi-hyperbolic in the one-dimensional case.
Subhyperbolic. Subhyperbolic, yes. So it is the condition of having non-recurrent. Well, so it is kind of stronger. So you see, so in the one-dimensional situation, subhyperbolicity means that you allow critical points on the Julia sets, and these critical points must be non-recurrent. And this would be the next stage. So we don't, in our condition, does not allow critical points on the Julia set at all. But there is a work by Bedford and Smiley who constructed some Hanon maps which are analogous to this kind of one-dimensional maps with non-recurrent critical points, and that would be precise analog. And I believe that our machinery can be generalized to the Bedford-Smiley situation, but it is not done yet.
So is J plus still laminated?
So J plus will be laminated, but it will be some orbifold lamination in that case. There would be finitely many orbifold points in this case. Yes.
So don't think about stability in this hyperbolic situation.
So it is not hyperbolic, it is like parabolic, and parabolic situation is not stable, of course. But what we can show is that this dominated after all this analysis we can show that these parabolic maps can be perturbed to a hyperbolic map. So they are on the boundary of a hyperbolic component, on the parameter hyperbolic component, which is not a priori obvious. If you have parabolic points, it's not a priori, but under this condition you can do this perturbation. That in this sense it is very close to stable situation. It could be perturbed to stable. If you perturb in the right direction, then you get stability.
Thanks again.
Thank you.